Thank you. So just a quick introduction. I am Rajeev. I work as a product engineer at Gojek. So I'm going to be talking about resiliency in distributed systems, how we learned lessons along the way, multiple downtimes along the way, right? So you can follow along here, go distis, bit.ly link. So we are, Gojek is a transport, logistics, hyperlocal delivery and payments. It is into that sector. And this is the scale at which we work. We have more than 300 plus microservices currently, and among them 100 plus are written in Go. So this will be the agenda, a quick basics of resiliency and distributed systems. Why do we care? And what are faults versus failures? And what are the patterns we learned along the way? So let's start with something like, what is distributed systems, right? Because we are talking about it. So distributed systems are these networked components which communicate and coordinate their action by passing messages, right? We all know that. So in a complex microservices architecture, as you have seen, there are multiple pieces which basically interact with each other to achieve a common goal. So those are your distributed systems. But for most of us, it looks something like this, right? If you are long enough there. Basically, because it's too complex to reason about, so if you don't have proper discipline to actually know what is happening. So what is resiliency, since we are talking about resiliency in distributed systems? So resiliency is capacity of a system to actually recover from difficulties, right? So all through the talk, we'll be discussing on how we build this resiliency, what are the some of the patterns we learned along the way. And you might ask, right, like, why as a me as a person should care about resiliency in my systems, in my microservices? So this is some of the points which will affect Gojek. So this is specific to Gojek. Like, basically, it could lead to financial losses for the company. It leads to losing of customers. It can affect your customers because customers are relying on your app to work to actually do about their daily livelihood. And also, it will potentially affect livelihood of our drivers because they are depending on you for your app to work, right? And it becomes much more critical in sectors like healthcare, wherein resiliency becomes extremely important because a person's life is on the line. So let's start with basic definitions of what are faults, what are failures. Let's like segregate them. So fault, I can think of it as something which is an incorrect internal state within your complex system, right? Like you have a system, it is some internal incorrect state. So what are the examples of it? So some of the examples include you have database slowdown, right? You have memory leaks, you have block threads. In Golang case, it is blocked Go routines. You have dependency failures, you have bad data which got propagated within your systems because you don't have proper validations. So all of these are examples of faults in your system. Like, let's take a simple example. Consider these are all the microservices which are there. Now, if you see customer profiles is one of the service which is like quite critical. Every other system is dependent on it. Now, what would happen if one of the dependency of customer profile consider a database slows down? Now, if you see, all the direct dependencies actually have a problem. They are shown in yellow, in the sense like they are affected. And voucher service is not because it's a transitive dependency. Now, this is what fault look like, wherein the systems which are dependent on a service which has a fault have a problem. Now, let's look into what is a failure. Now, failure is nothing but inability of the system to do its intended job. Like in Gojek's case, you can consider we take orders from the people. So if Gojek is unable to take orders from people, then it's a failure on Gojek's part. Now, this is what it will look like when you actually don't control the faults, which is all the systems are affected, including the transitive dependency, if you see here. And if you are unable to take orders, your business is down, as simple as that. Now, what we want to do is, if you think, resiliency is nothing but preventing faults turning into failures. You have faults always happening within your systems, and all you want to do is make sure that your systems recover from these difficulties and don't turn into failures. Now, resiliency in distributed systems is hard, right? It's not easy to achieve. For one, network is highly unreliable, as we all know, right? There are network latencies which might increase. There are network partitions which might occur within your system. And dependencies will always fail. I think I should change can to will because dependencies will fail. And you have to design your system thinking that dependencies actually fail. And users are unpredictable, right? So one example in Gojek's case, which I can think of is, so when our systems slow down, right, people tend to actually try more, which actually kills your system more, right? Like it's potentially DDoSing your own, like your users are DDoSing your systems, right? And that can actually lead to problems and crashes within your system. And also there is a nice dichotomy here, because if you see, the whole point we went with distributed systems was we didn't want a single point of failure, right? We wanted multiple systems so that even one goes down, we have this backup or redundancy. But now with distributed systems, we have much more other problems. So it is always trading off one set of problems with the other in computer science, if you see. Now let's go ahead and discuss some of the patterns which we learned along the way for actually building resiliency in your systems. Now we actually open source this library called as Himdal. It is at Gojek Tech Repo. So this basically inculcates some of these patterns which are learned, and this is written in Go. So we'll talk about this along the way. Okay, let's start with resiliency pattern zero. As we are all computer science people, we start with index zero, right? So no code, right? How many of you have seen this repository, right? Like almost everyone, right? So the best way to write secure and reliable applications is write nothing and deploy nowhere, right? And it had a crazy number of stars, right? Like that's the important part. But most of us, if you want to run a business, we can't just tell it, okay, we don't write code, we'll sit at home, right? So what is important is we might have to tend to go towards something called as less code, right? Because the more code you have, the more reasons for it to fail, right? And the more not resilient your code is, right? So what I could think of is, like, the lesser the code, the lower the reasons for it to fail. Also, the most resilient piece of code you ever write is the code you never wrote, right? So always think of writing less code. So let's start. Let's be serious and let's start with the one. So the next one is timeouts, right? So timeouts are extremely important. So it says you have to stop waiting for an answer when you know that it wouldn't come back. Now, where are timeouts required, right? Timeouts are required at all of your integration points in your microservice. Now, what are integration points, right? So integration points are your app when it's making an external call, it's making a call to some other dependent service, it's making a call to your storage layer, right? So those are your basically points of failure, because now you are actually over a medium which is unreliable, which is network. And the sad thing is, most of us go ahead and just initialize a HTTP client in Golang, and the default HTTP client waits forever. As we know, default HTTP client has a timeout which is infinite, right? Which means that if a goroutine is spawned for actually making a request, that goroutine is blocked forever. And the documentation itself says that default HTTP client is unsafe in production. Even then we use it, right? Now, all through the talk, let's consider the simple scenario wherein you have a service A and there is a service B, and service B has slowed down, right? And service A is making a call to service B for getting something back, some response. Now this is how, if you want to declare in Golang, like this uses the default HTTP client, right? And if you do something like this, you have this problem, right? At scale, if you're making a call to some other downstream service which is slow and is responding very slowly, you have a lot of blocked goroutines, right? Which might actually eat up resources of your service. And this is through a tool called as Gurman, which was recently written. It analyzes command line, through command line goroutines which are waiting. And if you see, this is the IO wait. Most of these are in IO wait state. So to make it explicit, we wrote a wrapper around HTTP client, which is Himdal, which I talked about, which will, in the constructor, takes a timeout, and you can use it to make requests. So at least it will make you explicitly think of there is a timeout, and this is how you set it. So how does timeouts help for us, right? One philosophy which we all want to go towards is fail fast, right? If something is not working out, if I'm trying to call something and it doesn't work out, I have to fail fast. And there are multiple reasons for this, right? So preventing cascading failures, in the sense like, you have a service B which has slowed down or has gone down, and you are waiting in your service, which is service A, forever to actually get response from service B, and it would never return back. So what you are potentially doing is using up all the resources on service A, which in turn lead to resource depletion on service A and service A going down or not processing actual requests from your users. You have blocking goroutines in that case. The other thing is that you need failure isolation, which means that if service B is down, that is not my problem. I shouldn't go down if service, some other dependent service is down, right? And timeouts help you basically fail fast and actually have this failure isolation. And you might be asking, how should I decide a timeout? What is a good timeout to have for my system? And most of the times, the standard rule is timeouts must be dependent on your dependencies SLA. Now, if your dependency says my SLA is around 10 MS, 99th percentile, I'm telling it's 10 MS, mostly your timeout would be around that. So let's go with the next pattern. It is retries, right? Now retry tells that you have to try again on failure. Like as we do in life, we just don't give up. We actually try, retry for that to come back again. So what does retries help? Retries help reduce your recovery time. Like consider you have a synchronous response request lifecycle and you're actually making a call to a service which is actually slower or might have a network glitch. Consider the scenario of A calling B. Now actually retries help you recover from these small network glitches, right? Because you actually want to serve a complete response for your user. So retries are actually helpful there. And this is how you can do retries in Hemdal. So it supports two backoff strategies with jitters. So backoff strategies which supports are constant backoffs and exponential backoffs. So backoffs are basically you have to wait for some time before making the next request. And you can set the retry count and retryer and various other things. And not everything is fine if you just use retries, right? Retrying immediately might not be useful all the time, right? Because what if your dependency has failed? It will take much more time to recover or come back online. So it wouldn't be helpful then. You're actually making your users to wait longer, though you're not getting any response back. So what potentially most of the places we do is we queue and retry later. Like it is, if it is something which can be queued and can be processed later, you actually queue it up in any of your queuing systems or message buses or whatever, and then basically retry it. Retry in your own sweet time. Now, if you're doing retries, idempotency becomes very important. Now, idempotency basically tells that if you make multiple operations, same operation, then the result should be the same, right? As simple as that. Now, if you retry non-idempotent APIs, you will lead into a bad inconsistent state. You have to make sure when you're trying to retry, your API is idempotent or the call which you're making is idempotent. And one classic example in Goje's case which I can think of is if the APIs are not idempotent, it could potentially lead to assigning multiple drivers to the same order, right? Because now your call to actually assigning a driver to an order is not idempotent. So let's go on to the next one, circuit breakers. So circuit breaker says that you have to stop making calls to save systems, your system as well as the system, the downstream system. Now this is the state transition diagram of a typical circuit breaker. Now when everything is well and good, right, the state transition diagram would look like, okay, it will be in the closed state, right? Your system state would be in the closed. Now if certain number of requests fail to the service B, consider service A and service B, you are making call to service B, and if certain number of requests fail, basically the circuit is tripped, and that goes to an open state. When you are in open state, what it will do is that it will basically circumvent all the calls which are going to the downstream service to actually save the downstream service or help it recover. Now, after a certain sleep period, what it does, it basically checks again and goes into a half open state. And once it goes into a half open state, it checks with another request to check whether the system is healthy. If it is healthy, it goes back to the closed state. And all the requests which are coming will actually make a call to service B. And all of us might have heard of Hystrix, right? This is a, like a classic implementation of a circuit breaker pattern, right? And it was open sourced by Netflix. Now this is how something you can do with Hemdal. Like you set various options like concurrent requests you want to go with, error present threshold, sleep window, request volume threshold, and bunch of other things. And you just make a request to the downstream service. And it will take care of all the state transitions which we just talked about. Now how does circuit breakers help us, right? Circuit breakers help us circumvent calls when system is unhealthy. When consider service B is unhealthy, I don't want to make calls to it, and I want B to recover. You fail fast. And it helps guard your integration points. As we talked, it basically fails fast, and it will guard from failures as well as cascading failures which will happen. Now, one of the important things is that you need to have metrics and monitoring, right? When you actually implement something like Hystrix within your integration points or on your integration points. Because you want to continuously know what is happening with your integration point, whether it's failing, whether it's succeeding, or is there a problem. So this is how a typical dashboard will look, right, in one of the service in Gojek. So if everything is well and good, everything looks green. But if there is a problem, everything goes red, right? As simple as that. So now let's go back to the fourth resiliency pattern. which talks about fallbacks. Like, how do you degrade gracefully, right? You just don't just fail. Now here, I want to talk about a service which is called as map service, right? We internally have a service called as map service, which is an interface to Google Maps API, right? Now, what we used to have is certain times when Google Maps API used to not meet its SLA, right? Like, if they consider like their SLA is some 10 MS, if they had a latency of 20 MS and like broke their SLAs, we used to have failures on Gojek side wherein the bookings used to fail because we were not resilient or tolerant against faults happening in our dependent systems. And since we don't have control over Google's Maps API, we can't really do anything about it, right? So the one of the good things to do about it is have fallbacks, right? When something doesn't work, which is not under your control, you have a sane fallback for it. Now, this is how a Gojek app will look. Like, when you actually book a ride from a source to a destination, you use Google Map for actually routing the distance on the map. We use Google Maps API for estimating the prices, estimating the distance, and various other things, right? We want to basically use this. When everything is good and healthy, it will look something like this. But when something is bad, what we do is we fall back from route distance, which we get from Google's Maps API, to something called as route approximation, right? When you actually don't get response back from Google, what you do is you basically have a route approximation. And we, in this case, we use a Haversian distance and some factor of it. It is basically a straight line distance, if you think. So this is how it will look like if you try to book a ride when actually our systems are working in a fault mode, faulted mode. So you show a straight path and not actually fail, right? Earlier, we didn't used to have bookings coming into our system because Google used to fail meeting the SLA. Now, the other option is potentially to fall back to a different maps provider, right? This is something which we are exploring, but we are not there yet. So these are all fallbacks which you can think of when you're actually building these systems. Now, how does these help, right? It actually help you degrade gracefully. In the sense, like if the dependency is failing, let me think of some kind of fallback so that I don't break my critical flows. And yeah, as we told, it helps protect your critical flows. In our case, it was the booking flow. Our bookings used to fail because of this. And one important takeaway with this is you have to think of fallbacks at all of your integration points, right? And Hystrix actually makes you think explicitly about these fallbacks because it has a fallback callback which you can actually provide to it to tell what if my circuit opens, what should I do? Should I send a degraded response back? Should I fall back to a straight line distance, right? Should I fall back to a different maps provider? So all of these are the options which you can actually explore. Now the last part is resiliency testing, right? So what do you do with your systems is you test it to actually break your systems and then learn their behavior and try to fix them. So one important part in this is you have to find all the failure modes within your ecosystem, right? Like consider you are building a microservice and you are actually making a call to your dependency like a storage layer or you are making a call to some third party service. What you do is that you come up with all the scenarios in which actually something will fail. Like for example, what if there is an increase in latency to my database call? What if my Redis goes down, right? If you have a caching layer. So what if my packets are dropped? If there is a network partition between two services, what should I do then, right? So if you think of all of these scenarios, it will help you think, what are my fallbacks during these scenarios? So what you tend to do is that you tend to build a test harness among all of these scenarios which you have come up with. Like the test harness is basically something which you can actually run on your build, telling that, okay, I will run this and I will see that all of my checks are actually passing. Now, one of the important thing is within resiliency testing is injection of failures, right? So instead of failures happening in unexpected ways in production and then affecting your booking flow, rather what you do is that you inject failures within your system in a controlled manner and then actually understand the behavior of your system and then fix it accordingly. Now, what does it help us do is, since in a complex distributed microservice architecture, the state space is lot, it's huge, right? The way your systems break is, I don't know, in orders of hundreds, right? There is a lot of unknown unknowns you will never cover. So what you do is, rather proactively, you check that state space for failures and try to fix some of them. And some of the classic cases is the Simian Army by Netflix, right? Like they have all of these monkey which bring down a particular host, randomly goes and kills a host, randomly goes and brings down the whole data center or region, right? Like it just depends on what kind of tolerance you want within your system. And based on that, you use these tools to actually test it out. So what we are doing at Gojek is currently not using any of this, but what we are doing is that manually bringing down services, so it is a part of going to production, wherein you actually build, bring down your dependencies and check what kind of fallbacks you have before actually taking it to production. So that itself can help you actually fix most of the resiliency problems. There are more patterns to it. There is rate limiting, throttling. You can do bulk heading, which I can't cover all of these today because of time constraints. There is queuing. You can actually queue to be resilient. You can monitor, alert, canary releases. You can have redundancies. So all of these patterns actually help make your systems tolerant against failures. So in conclusion, what I can say is, patterns are no silver bullet, right? Like we have learned these five patterns and you might go ahead and learn some 10 patterns of resiliency. As with anything, these are no silver bullet. What these can help you is restrict some of these failures to happen. It will basically help you prevent faults turning into failures and help you build tolerance among your systems. And also the other sad truth of distributed systems, and I think in general life, is systems fail, right? And we have to deal with it, right? There is no other way. And the only thing which you can do to help go with this is, you can actually design your systems for failure. You have to expect failures, proactively expect that failures will happen. Your dependencies will fail, your databases will go down, your caching layer will go down. And think what you should do during those times. So a quick recap. So we discussed what are faults versus failures. We discussed some of the patterns like timeouts, retries, circuit breakers, fallbacks, resiliency testing. And most of these lessons, right, are learned by actually when systems went down in production and we were firefighting for it to get back up, right? So there are a lot of war stories to share with you guys. Come meet us at our booth. And also, who has read this book, released it by Michael Nygaard? Okay, only few folks. So I would highly recommend this book. So if you're working in any kind of microservice architecture, right, which has a lot of moving parts, this book is a seminal work in actually all of these patterns which we just discussed. In this book, the author discusses the anti-patterns, the patterns, so capacity planning and multiple other things, right? So I would highly recommend checking this out. And these are some of the responses, references. So the last two links actually point to the blog post, which is much more in detail about all of these resiliency patterns. So all the resiliency patterns among 10, 11 of them have been documented there. Cool, thanks for listening. And we are hiring. Yeah, thank you.